desire and give source to its life. Yet conceals it to breathe the coolness of night. None can fathom indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All-powerful, untamable. You put us all to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable. You see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. So I'm going to talk a little bit. Actually, I talk quite a bit, so I apologize. I always tell people, if you came out to hear an entertainer, you came to the wrong place, because that's not my calling. My calling is to preach the word. And I was so blessed last night to be at that gathering and just... I said, I haven't seen a group like that where people just come together and get up and sing and praise God, and it was just awesome, so it was really nice. But just a little bit about my story. I was kind of going to weave that through the program today, but I came to know the Lord in 1982. And the story was, my mom's best friend, Dorothy, from childhood, was over at our house one day. She'd come over a couple times a year, and we would call her Aunt Dottie, you know, just the way we did it back then. I still call her Aunt Dottie. But, you know, she was upstairs talking with my mom, and all of a sudden I heard some yelling at the table upstairs, and that was really uncommon, because my mom never yelled, and my Aunt Dottie's like one of the sweetest people you could ever imagine. And my aunt walked downstairs, and I was sitting in my bedroom playing my guitar, and I was 20 years old in 1982, and she asked me a question. She said, George, if you were to die today and stand before the gates of heaven, and God asked you, why should I let you into heaven, what would you say? I said, I don't know. You know, I was an altar boy growing up. I played in the church choir and, you know, even went to a juvenile detention facility once and did a Christmas concert there with the choir. So I think I've been pretty good. She says, well, you know, none of that really matters. She says, because the Word of God tells us that all of our righteousness is a filthy rag, that there's none righteous, and that we don't come to God based upon our own righteousness. We come to God based upon His righteousness. And he said, you know, the Bible tells us that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
He said that eternal life is a gift. And a gift is not something you earn. A gift is something you receive. And she said, would you like to receive that gift? And I said, well, yes. And so we prayed together. And I confessed with my mouth the Lord Jesus and believed in my heart that God raised him from the dead. And I know that I'm saved.
Amen.
And, you know, it was really interesting because growing up Catholic, most Catholics like me who become believers, we do everything to extremes. So, you know, you go from Catholicism right over to Pentecostalism, right? So I went to the Assembly of God to work with Jim and Tammy Baker for a while down in Rock Hill, South Carolina, working as a bodyguard for them. That was an interesting thing. Came back to Chicago and got my youth pastoring credentials to the Assembly of God Church and started a radio show in Chicago called TNT, Teens Need to Talk, and it aired on radio station WCRM, where Christians Receive Ministry, 103.9 FM. And you know, I just had this wonderful walk for so many years with the Lord. I was doing juvenile detention ministry, playing music in there, and I'm going to weave all this together as we go, but I wanted to kind of lay a little bit of a foundation so you knew where I was coming from. But you know, in bouncing around from the Pentecostal churches to the Southern Baptist was my next move. And I kind of worked my way through the Plymouth Brethren and a whole bunch of other places. But in the process, God was teaching me and I was learning. And praise God for that. But I fell in love with the old hymns. And I love to sing them. I love to sing them because a lot of my crowd are people my age or older. But it's also wonderful when I have young people in the group, because so many of them today haven't heard these songs, which is amazing.
Yes,
it is. And so I love to share them, and I'm always amazed at their response. So I'm going to switch guitars real quick. So Bonnie and I, my wife, who is in there not feeling well, praise God, I'm trusting that the Lord is working on her right now even, and she's going to be out here soon. The one of the groups we belong to is a church called Mission Church in And Mission Church is a very young church. It's a lot of very young families in that. There's about 2,000 people that go there. And the gentleman who pastored and founded that church, his dad was the senior pastor at Medina Baptist Church in Illinois. And that was a church with about 800 people. He retired after many years of leading that church and moved to Atlanta. And his son called him and said, hey, Dad, a lot of the people from the church have left there and are coming over here, and we don't really have people to minister to them. Would you mind coming out of retirement and coming back? So he did. They came up, and he started a group there called Legacy, which is for people 55 and older. And Bonnie and I got heavily involved with that, and he asked me one day to come and sing some songs to for one of our Thursday evening gatherings. And when he announced me, he says, here's the problem. He plays these wonderful songs, but you won't recognize any of them because he doesn't sing them right. So, yeah, just the way it is. I sing them the way I feel them. So, please, sing along with these. Let's do the Old Rugged Cross, one of my favorite songs. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, were the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
to the old rugged cross. I would ever be true. It's shame and reproach, gladly bent. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Yes, I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
So I'll tell you in a minute why I have to use music. There is a reason behind having to read music after all these years. But you know, last year when our legacy group at Mission Church, when the church is shut down, I'm so glad to hear that you guys did. Praise God for that. It broke my heart to see the church is closed, because this is just the beginning of the persecutions and the trials that the church is going to face as we get closer and closer to the Lord's return. If we buckle every time, you know, we face some opposition, we're in trouble. And so I'm so glad to find pastors and churches and elders that come together and say, you know what, we're going to stay open. And thank God for that. But we had so many in our legacy group. Again, remember, everybody's 55 and older. The average age is probably about 70. And, you know, a lot of seniors really struggle with technology. So while a lot of churches are going to Facebook Live and doing all these Zoom meetings and different things like that to try to stay connected, a lot of the elderly folks were having trouble with that. And I was hearing from a lot of them, and they were scared to death because, you know, they couldn't see their kids, you know. They couldn't go to church. They couldn't be connected to people. They were scared. And it was breaking my heart, and I was praying about it and just, you know, asking the Lord what we can do. And the Lord just kind of spoke to me, and he said, you know, he said, remember when I called Peter to step out of the boat to walk in? He said, the storms were raging, the winds were blowing, the waves were crashing. You know, but as long as he had his eyes fixed on me, he was able to walk above the storm. He said, but like so many of us, we take our eyes off of the Lord, start to look at our circumstances, and we start to fear, and fear gives way to our faith, doubting, and we start to doubt. And it's this nasty spiral that takes us down. And the Lord told me, he says, just remind them to keep their eyes fixed on me. And that was a beautiful song written by Helen Horlath Lemmel years ago called Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. I think it's about that song. Let's sing that, and then we'll move on to some other stuff. Oh, so are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness to see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Just turn your eyes upon Jesus and look forward in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strange in the light of his glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, he passed and we follow him there. Over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Just turn your eyes upon Jesus and look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Well, his word shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him, and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying. His perfect salvation to tell. Yes, turn your eyes upon Jesus and look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Yes, the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you.
suppose y'all won't mind if I... Oh, breakaway.
So it's so wonderful that George and Bonnie, you know, came with their time and come with their gifts and their talents, their anointing from God. We're going to take up an offering for them. We're going to keep it separate. The offering is this offering is for George and his wife and their ministry. Amen. Remember, we're not giving to George and Bonnie, we're giving to God. Amen. So I pray a blessing, a double portion of your anointing upon this offering, this love offering to George and to Bonnie. And thank you, Father, for blessing each of them this very day. Amen. So as you give, if you're making out a check, make it out to George Nicholson. And if you're giving cash, don't worry about it.
So if I can, I'd like to just open the Word. It wouldn't be a Sunday morning worship service if we didn't open the Word of God. And, you know, one of my favorite chapters in the Scriptures is in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15. And it's the Gospel, it's the paragraph, it's the chapter, if you can talk right there. It's the chapter of lost things. And I know you all have heard this story a million times, but I'm going to read it partially again. And what I really want you to focus on is the Father. Okay? Focus on the Father. Starting in Luke chapter 15, verse 11. So then Jesus said, a man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me. So he divided his wealth between them. And not many days later, the younger son gathered everything together and went on a journey into a distant country. And there he squandered his estate with loose living. Now when he had spent everything, a severe famine occurred in that country, and he began to be impoverished. So he went and he hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country. And he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine were eating, and no one was giving anything to him. But when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread? But I am dying here with hunger. I will get up and go to my father and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired men. So he got up and he came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion for him, and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his slaves, quickly, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fattened calf, kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found. And they began to celebrate. Amen. You know, when I think of that story, I think of this young man who traveled across the Palestinian desert into a distant land. It wasn't a nearby land, it was a distant land. He had to go away. And he got there, and at some point things went bad, and he spent all his money, and he's in a pigsty, basically feeding pigs. And I'm just imagining this is a hot, sweaty job. Pig manure and all that stuff around. And I can just imagine how grotesque he must have smelled and looked and everything. And if that weren't bad enough, then he hiked all the way back across the desert to get back to his father. And what amazes me, there's so many different things that amaze me, but one is that, so is that while he was still a long way off, the father saw him. How precious to know that God is always waiting for that moment when we come to our senses and we turn and we repent. Turn to him. And he doesn't just wait for us to get there, and he doesn't say, go clean up and take a shower and put on some new clothes, and, you know, get your life right and holy and all that stuff. He comes to us right where we are. Yes. And like the prodigal son, he embraced him and he kissed him. But the most beautiful part of that is in all that filth, all that sin, the father says, bring out the best robe. The King James says, the finest robe. Which is a beautiful picture of Christ.
Yes.
And it's his righteousness.
Yeah.
And God covers us in a robe of Christ. He covers us in Christ's righteousness.
Yes.
with all that filth and sin and all that garbage still there and present in our lives. But God doesn't see that.
Amen.
He now sees Christ, and he sees Christ's righteousness. And now the Holy Spirit goes to work. And he spends the rest of the journey. People always say, I need more Jesus. I know, you're born again. You got all the Jesus you're ever going to have. The rest of your journey is about taking up your cross daily and putting to death self. Right? And it's a precious thing. And how do you begin to even fathom God's mercy? How do you begin to fathom his grace? We sang about those at the old rugged cross, beautiful picture of God's mercy. We see it in the amazing grace, God's incredible grace. There's a song written by a young man by the name of Caden Slade. Nobody's ever heard of him. But he's a young man, he's an artist, he's a current Christian artist. And he wrote this song, and it just, every time I hear him sing it, it just melts me, literally melts me. I cry, you can ask Bonnie, I'll play it at night sometimes laying in bed, and I just start to get tears roll out of my eyes because I know how far I've traveled. I know how far that distant land was in my life. And, as I was going through those years of coming to know God, there's a song by a band called Casting Crowns. It's a song called Slow Fade. It says, families don't crumble in a day, lives don't crumble in a day. It's a slow fade. One compromising step at a time, and pretty soon we're a long way away. I owned a couple of businesses and had great success with those businesses. And, for years I had been raising my kids on my own and doing ministry work and all of that, but my businesses started to become successful, and I started thinking to myself, your kids are off to college, it's time to just maybe start enjoying, relax a little bit, start enjoying life like the fool who was building bigger barns, right? And I did. I started taking one step after another in the wrong direction, and pretty soon I found myself a long way with businesses that were successful, but driving ridiculously expensive cars and eating at ridiculously expensive restaurants in Chicago on a regular basis and blowing tons of money. And then one day I was watching a Bulls game at Bulls and the Magic. Came out of that game and left a few minutes early because we were going to go over to Taylor Street in Chicago and have some Italian food. Walked out the doors, and all of a sudden I just said, well, I feel really, really dizzy. And the woman I was dating at the time looked at me and saw that I was white as a ghost. And her husband was a doctor, and she knew right away I was having a heart attack. So she moved me to stand by a post to kind of hold on, and there was a young couple outside smoking. And I remember her telling him, don't let him hit his head when he goes down. And she started running out of the parking lot screaming. And my last memory was this, on my knees, this big burly paramedic running to me in super slow motions. It's burned in my brain. And the next thing I woke up in Rush Medical Center's emergency room. And in that process, yeah, praise God for that. But in between there, apparently my heart went into V-fib, so it stopped beating and for about 5 minutes. And 7 minutes and you were gone, or 5 minutes. They got me, they were able to defibrillate my heart twice. The second time they got it beating again. And I spent the next 6 days in cardiac ICU at Rush. And it's a teaching hospital, so there was a lot of, doctors and students and stuff there. And all week long they were coming in saying, you're the guy everyone's talking about, you're not supposed to be here. Well, I did a little research, found out that VFib, only 15% of the people who go into VFib survive.
That's it. Yes.
And of the 15% who do go into VFib, only 30% survive without brain damage.
That's right.
Because the first thing that happened was I lost oxygen to the brain and got dizzy. So I started thinking about just God's grace and his sovereignty. If I would have stayed in the game to the end of the game, I wouldn't be here. Because there's no way they would have been able to get the paramedics to me in time. If we had left 5 minutes earlier, we would have been in our car starting to head down the Eisenhower Expressway. I wouldn't be here. The fact that we got outside where there was nobody, and there just happened to be a security truck right there with his lights on it, the woman I was with saw, they were able to get the ambulance to me quick. So I think of those things, and I just realized how precious life is. And kind of made a commitment to the Lord at that time that, I don't want to waste any more years. I want to live my life deliberately, and I want to live it with purpose. And this is a really beautiful song called Mercy of Jesus. I'm no stranger to sin, and I've hurt you so. I don't do what I ought. I don't live what I know, but I fall in your arms.
cry, Father, I've lost. The battle was long. The lines were all crossed. But oh, the mercy of Jesus, it covers us worst ones. It covers me. And your blood, the greatest of fountains, oh mighty ocean, please cover me. I've squandered my love, and I've spent all my life. I find myself lost, 'cause I chose to hide. Oh Savior, come save me. I'm sick and in need. I've done to me. And oh, the mercy of Jesus, it covers us worst ones. It covers me. And your blood, the greatest of fountains, oh mighty ocean, please cover me. All the sins of the world were washed by your blood when you spilled out your love. Does your heart still pour out? Forgive all my sin, oh dear mercy, I run. And oh, mercy of Jesus, it covers us worst ones, it covers me, and your blood, the greatest of fountains, oh mighty ocean, please cover me. Mercy of Jesus, please cover me.
God spoke to my heart, and he says, have I ever let you down? Have I ever let you down? Amen. Many of us have gone through struggles, trials, and tribulations, but has God always been there?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. He doesn't leave us. Amen. So as much as we can worry about finances, and worry about housing, and worry about jobs,
yes,
we need to kick it back and say, why am I worrying?
Amen.
Amen. There's no fear in Christ Jesus, and that's what usually ends up by you worrying. You've got a fear. Amen. So we bind that fear and cast it out in the name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to take up an offering for the church. Amen. God has provided. God will provide. But he provides through each of us. Amen. As well as he. I love when God says, I'll open the windows of heaven and pour blessing upon you. God is so wonderful. Amen. Eleanor, could you come, Eleanor? Father, as I lay my hands, as my wife lays her hands upon our offering, Lord, I pray, Father, your blessing upon each one here. I thank you, Father, for your anointing. I thank you for your power. I thank you, God, that you said you will never take us to a place where you haven't already provided. Father, touch each one here as they give. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. Well, taking the offering, I want to... Has anybody ever heard of a guy by the name of Morris Chapman?
Yeah.
That's the first time anybody has said yes to that question. That's awesome. Praise God.
I go fly over there.
I came to know Morris Chapman's music back in like 1987, 88.
Gentleman
was the lead singer in a Christian band I had back in the late 80s, early 90s. He's 10 years younger than I am. I hired him as a salesman in my company, and we take road trips together. We were traveling to Iowa from Chicago to Iowa to Des Moines, and he said, "Hey, I want to play this tape for you." So he popped in a cassette of Morris Chapman from his album The Artist. And, I have such great memories as we're crossing the Mississippi River of hearing this song, and it's burned, it's etched into my spirit, and I just love it. But he wrote this song called The Artist, and I want to play it for you because it really fits in nicely with where we've been moving this discussion this morning. But, you know, if you have an Alexa at home, there's only one way you can ever find this music, because you can't find it on YouTube, you can't find it anywhere for some bizarre reason. But if you tell Alexa, I had to figure this out the hard way, Alexa, play the album The Artist by Morris Chapman, it'll find it. If you say, hey Alexa, play The Artist by Morris Chapman, she can't find it, right? You have to say, Alexa, play the album The Artist by Morris Chapman, and it finds it. What's funny about that is we were doing a concert in Michigan a few weeks ago, and there was a gentleman in his mid-80s, couldn't make the concert, and so he was listening online to the live feed that they were doing. And when I said that, his Alexa started playing the album The Artist. So that was pretty funny. But anyways, I'm going to play this, and then I'm going to do a few of my own songs and try to get us out of here in the next 30 minutes. So. The artist lifted the canvas, and he sketched each line carefully. Watched as the picture unfolded. It was shaped in the image of me. The shadows were deepened with sorrow, and the brow was wrinkled with pain. The eyes were sad and so empty, a picture of sorrow and shame. He painted a heart that was broken, torn and scarred deep within, and bitter from life's disappointment, and framed with the blackness of sin. I looked in the eyes of the artist. I trembled and I reached for his hand. And I cried, oh Master Creator, transform me and paint me again. So he smiled and he lifted the canvas, and he started all over again, remolding and shaping the image. How graceful the touch of his hand. He painted a heart that was mended. He erased all the guilt and the sin, and he framed it with colors of crimson. I posed and he painted again. Yes, he painted a heart that was mended. He erased all the guilt and the sin, and he framed it with colors of crimson. I posed and he painted again.
Yes, I pulled, and he painted again.
I'll jump into a few songs that I wrote many years ago. So I had given up on music a long time ago, probably a little over 10 years ago, as my life was cruising along and I started traveling down the wrong roads. Not only did my Bible sit unattended to with lots of dust on it, but so did my guitar. And I even forgot I had a guitar. That's how far back it had been. And I started attending a church over in Aurora, Illinois, called the Warehouse Church. And Warehouse Church started 33 years ago by a bunch of hippie bikers. Started in a warehouse in downtown Aurora, and it was basically homeless people and ex-cons and drug addicts, and those were the people who were coming there for a Wednesday night Bible study. And it grew to the point where they said, well, why don't we just start having Sunday services as well? So they did. And here, 33 years later, the church is still going, and they do something called Motorcycle Sunday every year. Haven't done for the last 2 years because of the COVID stuff, but usually they'd get 1,000 bikers just from Chicago and all over to travel there for that. And it was really a great chance to minister to people who probably would never go to church, but it was a big biker event and they would come. But the pastor of the church one day, we were talking, we had lunch, and he said, we were talking about garage bands growing up. And I said, oh yeah, I played garage bands. He goes, oh, what do you play? I said, well, I used to play guitar. He goes, what do you mean you used to? He said, well, we could use some help with worship here. Take out your guitar and learn how to play it again and come back and we'll get you on some worship. So a few months later, I got up and played a couple of songs, and then God just started to open doors for me. And you know, the interesting thing is that there's sometimes things in our life that become idols. And music had become an idol to me. I didn't go to God when I was sad, when I was depressed. I would pick up my guitar or sit at the piano, and I would play for endless hours and just soothe myself. And that had become an idol to me. And so God allowed that to be taken away. Until the point now where I care less if I play or not. I never practice. The fact that it all came back so quick was really amazing. But anyways, you know, there was a saying by John Lennon, and I hate to bring up secular people in Christian presentations.
It is what it is.
But he made a comment one time, and he said, life is what happens while you're making other plans. And that's so true. I meet so many people, and I talk to them, I mean, they tell me, they ask me, they say, well, how you doing with your reading of your Bible? Well, you know, whenever I have time, I really don't have a lot of time to do that. And I said, well, then what are you putting your faith on? You tell me that you walk by faith, but what are you anchoring your faith on if you don't read the Bible? You know, I mean, the Bible says that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. It's God's Word that we anchor our faith on, not what some song sings about or anything like that. If you don't know the Word of God, you really have a difficult time anchoring your faith. And without faith, it's impossible to please God. So my suggestion is, seek first the kingdom of God, open your Bible up, get up 15 minutes earlier if you have to, open your Bible every day and start your day with that. But this song kind of talks about that. I wrote this many years ago. It's a song called Living Life. Sometimes it feels like heaven's just a bit too far away. Life gets so busy, it's enough just thinking about today. There's careers to build and bills to pay, kids to raise along the way. There just never seems to be enough time to pray. The years roll by a little faster every day. See, time just steals your life away. So much to see, so much to do. Living life is killing you. Just never seems to be enough time to pray. There never seems to be enough time to say, thank you for loving me, for reaching down and saving me. And thank you for the riches of your grace. Thank you for giving me a life to live eternally, Lord. Teach me how to live it on the way. Teach me to live by faith. So the valleys grow a little deeper.
deeper every day. And the trials burn like fires on the way. Rejoicing on the mountaintops, wish somehow the world could stop, cause another valley's just one step away. But the valley's where we learn to walk by faith. Thank you for loving me, for reaching down and saving me. Thank you for the riches of your grace. Thank you for giving me a life to live eternally. Oh, teach me how to live it all the way. Teach me to live by faith. And when the storms of life arise and despair hangs like curtains on your eyes, and the rains keep falling down to the point that you feel you're gonna drown, thank you for loving me, for reaching down and saving me. Thank you for the riches of your grace. Thank you for giving me a life to live eternally. Oh, teach me how to live it on the way. Teach me to live by faith. Teach me to live by faith.
Back in 2013, and he had asked me to write him a song. You know, it's a hard thing when you write a song for somebody, because that song is kind of just a thing that's how you see their life, and it's kind of my son. I wrote one for my son Luke for his 17th birthday, and he still plays it all the time all these years later. It's just something that just means so much to him. But when I thought about my dad, I thought about ripples. And how you drop a little stone into a pond and the ripples start to expand out. And I started thinking about how one life touches another life, touches another life, touches another life. And the one thing my dad did was touched a lot of lives.
Amen.
And he was a big man. He was 6'4", 350 pounds before he got cancer. And he battled cancer for about 5 years, and he actually got much shorter all of a sudden. I know he got much shorter and much skinnier. But I never will forget, and all the grandkids and all of them will never forget, just he was at every event. He went to the granddaughter's ballet recitals or plays and different things. He was at every one of his grandson's sporting events and things. He just never missed. He would travel with me up to northern Wisconsin to see my older boy play football in college and that. And he just never wanted to miss anything. And it really spoke to me. And it's, you know, in life we get really busy sometimes, and we tend to get focused on all the things that are just in our immediate world. But you know, with my grandkids now, I find that time so precious. That's those little moments I can spend with them, that I can leave such a lasting impression. Because when I look back at all of my nieces and nephews and how they think of their grandfather so fondly, and the memories they have, the little things he did just by attending an event, I bring all that up to say that as busy as we all get, you know, find time with the ones you love to just be there. And so I wrote this song years ago for my two boys called Going Fishing. Morning breaks through my window, the sunlight touches my eyes. Two little voices from down the hall are telling me it's time to arise. We go fishing, Dad, just like you say. Looks like a beautiful day. We've got our fishing poles out by the door. Can we, Dad, would it be okay?
patiently passing the time. Three little bobbers, they dance on the water, waiting for a bite on the line. I tell them all about the love God graciously imparts, and how he ever waits patiently, hoping to catch our hearts. Starts to rain, the fish aren't bite, and smiles begin to fade away. I say, let's wait just a little bit longer, it's still quite early in the day. Then quick as it started, it came to an end, and the sun was brighter than. Just like that, the fish started biting, the hope that we'd been waiting for. I tell them all about the love God graciously imparts, and how he ever waits patiently, hoping to catch our hearts. Through every life, God patiently waits, through the blessings and the storms. After the rain, that his love shines brighter than we ever really noticed before. Yes, it's after the rain, that his love shines brighter than we ever really noticed before.
So about a month ago, I was on a Saturday afternoon, I was just sitting in my office, my home office, just picking up my guitar and doodling around on it. All of a sudden, this song popped into my head. And I had completely forgotten that I wrote this song. And it was totally, like I said, the reason I used music up here is because my memory is so bad now since the heart attack. And can't remember so many of my songs. But this one just popped back into my head, and I played for Bonnie. I said, what do you think of this song? And she goes, oh, I love that song. You need to play that. So, okay, this is a song called Fly.
Fly, mount up with wings, and soar like an eagle in the sky. Rise high upon the winds of the grace of God in Jesus Christ. I am persuaded neither height nor depth could ever separate us from God's love in Christ. So fly and dive into the depths of the tender mercies of our God. Die bearing your cross every moment of your life. I am persuaded neither life nor death could ever separate us from God's love in Christ. So die. And climb out of the ashes to find no more tears in your eyes. And cling to the heart of Jesus, resting by faith you will find grace to abide as you fly. Worship the Lord on high. Fly, just fly.
songs for you. These are the first two Christian songs I ever wrote. I kind of told you when I was younger, I did a Christmas program at the Illinois Youth Center in Valley View. And I was like 12, 13 years old and playing with the church choir, swinging singers, that's what we were called at the Catholic Church. And there's all these junior high school kids in there. But we were invited to go and do a Christmas program. As we were sitting in the bus outside of the facility, I was thinking, you know, we're going to go in, sing songs for an hour or so, we're going to leave and go home to our families, and we're going to have Christmas, and we're going to open presents and do all that. But inside these walls are a bunch of kids who aren't going to be able to do that. And I don't know if you've ever been in a prison, whether going to serve there, or I hope you have been there, I hope. Over here looks like you've been in prison. There's an oppression there. When you walk through the gates, even in a juvenile detention facility, there's a darkness. And it's tangible. I mean, you feel it on your skin, you feel it in your soul. And man, that scared me to death. And I'm thinking, man, inside this building is a bunch of 13, 14-year-old kids who are scared to death. They don't know what the future holds. They don't know if they're going to have to go on to an adult facility or what when they get out of here. And that really broke my heart. But it was interesting because many years later, like a week after I came to know the Lord, believe it or not, I wrote this song. And it's called The Prisoner. And it's just interesting because after that, the Lord kind of led me into 15 years of doing juvenile detention prison ministry all over northern Illinois. I started going down recently before COVID hit to Cook County Jail, Divisions 9 and 10, which are, Cook County Jail is the largest jail facility in the country. And Divisions 9 and 10 are the maximum security ones. And so it was really interesting to go in there and be able to just share the gospel with people who, in many cases, only thought of God as a judge, right? And to go in there and hold up the Bible and say, you probably don't realize this, but this is a love story. It's not a book of rules and do's and don'ts. It's a book of a God pursuing you, who loves you and wants to be in a relationship with you. And most of them have never heard that story. And so anyways, that's kind of what this song is about. It's called The Prisoner. Once I heard a story when I was just a boy about an old and lonely prisoner whose life was robbed of joy. But one day something happened and it changed his life that day. He heard about how Jesus died, how he might be saved. Now when he heard, he got down on his knees and he did pray that Jesus would come into his heart and wash his sins away. And just then something happened the world won't understand. His broken life was made by the touch of God's own hand. So don't give up on life when life gives up on you. Because Jesus takes the old and broken heart and makes it new. Many people laughed at him. They had heard he'd found a savior who had freed him, while to them he still was bound. But deep inside his heart, he knew that it was true. He found a living savior that the scoffers never knew. So don't give up on life when life gives up on you. Jesus takes the old and broken heart and makes it new. Now many years had passed behind those prison walls, but deep inside his heart he knew he wasn't bound at all. And when he felt discouraged, alone or just afraid, he got down on his knees inside a cell and there he prayed. One night when he fell asleep, he never did awake. But he left the world this message through the smile upon his face. He said, Jesus freely died
that all men might be free. And if he lives within your heart, you're free eternally. My phone decided to chime in. In church, the pastor would just yell out, that'll be a cheese and sausage, thank you. Song I ever wrote. Going all the way back to the beginning of our conversation today, when I told you my Aunt Dottie was over at our house, and upstairs talking to my mom at the kitchen table, and then all of a sudden there was some yelling that broke out, and my aunt came downstairs by me. And I want to kind of fill in what happened up at the table between these two good friends, lifelong friends. My mom was a very, very religious person. I mean, she was with Catholic, she grew up Catholic, she was very devoted to her church, she would make dinners for the priests and take them to the rectory, she would drive people around to different appointments, doctor appointments, and help, you know, people who were disabilities. You know, she loved her church, she was in all the committees and doing things like that. Our house was our front door was a turnstile. We had so many people coming and living in our home over the years, aunts and uncles and cousins living in the basement because they needed help, or neighbors even that had a house where their house was being worked on. They had a place. That was our house. I mean, I had foster brothers for a while. I was the only boy with three sisters. We ended up adopting a girl, so we had four girls in the house then. Some foster brothers. That was, you could kind of get the idea. Our house always had tons of people staying there. That was just my mom. She just loved everybody. Saturdays and Sundays, we had the swimming pool. So all the aunts and uncles and cousins and grandparents, everybody piled into our house. And, you know, it was just an amazing childhood growing up with all of that. I mean, I remember I laughed finally now about my dad. He never did quite master those frozen burger patties on the grill, because every time they would just come out charred beyond recognition. But, you know, everyone would just smile and smother them in ketchup and mustard. And, my mom was a very loving person. And, you know, the first murder in the world was committed by who? The first murder in the world was committed by a religious man too proud to come to God on God's terms. Cain. Cain was a religious man. Adam and Eve's son. We know he was religious because he brought an offering to God. You know, and if you go back into the garden and you think about Adam and Eve, and they sinned and they fell and they hid and they tried to cover themselves up with a leaf. And God said, no. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. The wages of sin is death. Something's got to die. And so he killed an animal. And he covered him with the skin of the animal. And when you're in paradise, where everything is just beautiful and just amazing, and all of a sudden God kills an animal, an innocent animal that didn't do anything, it sheds its blood, covers you with the skin of it, I would think that would make an indelible impression on Adam. On just how vile sin is. And I'm sure they would have shared that with their sons. Listen, when you screw up and you bring an offering to God, the wages of sin is death. You know, you offer an offering to God that's acceptable to him. Cain decided he was just going to bring to God what he felt he wanted to bring to God. So he brought the work of his hands, tilling the ground, you know, fruit. God rejected his offering. His younger brother Abel, brought from the first of his flock. And shed its blood and offered that to God. And God accepted his offering. And Cain didn't like that. And religious people don't like that. Religious people like to stand on their own righteousness. That's, you know, kind of the core of sin. The center of the word sin is the letter I. I will be my own God. I will please myself. I will do what's right in my own eyes. And tell a religious person that all their good works means nothing to God, they get kind of angry. My mom got angry. Because my aunt had told her that, Carol, all of those things that you've done your whole life don't mean anything. You don't come to God based upon your good works. You come to God and accept the gift that he has for you. And she didn't like that. She got angry. And so my aunt came down and talked to me and then left. But thank God my aunt was praying hard for my mom. And a couple days later, my mom did come to accept Christ.
Oh, praise God.
And we're so thankful that she did, because that was in 1982. In 1992, she went home to be with the Lord at the age of 56. She died of pancreatic cancer. In the 10 years in between, she battled all sorts of cancer. She had breast cancer, lost both of her breasts. She battled all sorts of stomach problems and things like that. She was always in the hospital. And eventually, she withered away to 68 pounds and
I remember a couple days before she passed, they brought her home from the hospital, and the hospice brought a bed in. And I had to pick up my mom off her bed while they brought the hospice bed in. And I held my mom, who was just bone. She was 5'7", 68 pounds. It was just, I'll never forget it. It's etched into my heart and my memory forever, how precious she was. And in all those years, she never cursed God. She loved God. She loved the scripture. She loved the Psalms. In fact, her last day, as her feet were, you know, the hospice came in the morning and said, it'll be today. Her feet were ice cold. They were turning blue. Her blood was, her heart was starting to slow down. And so all the family piled into the house all day, and every day, people were sitting on the bed reading the Psalms to her. That's all she wanted to hear. She had lost her eyesight the last day, so she couldn't read it herself. And so just here in the house, the Psalms being read. And when she passed, that peace that she had affected so many people. My sisters, my brother-in-laws, family and friends, and I'm so thankful that from at least appearance, they all appear to be saved to me. Her one life touched so many lives, and that faith that she had. I had a brother-in-law who was given a Bible by the same lady who led me to the Lord. Gave him a Bible with his name and printed on it. He took it, chucked it in the garbage can, said, don't you ever be out there. And he gave him a Christ. Because he saw that it wasn't just words in a book, it was living in this person, this faith that this person had against such odds, just loved her Lord and couldn't wait to get home to hear her. And so I'm going to close with a song I wrote, and I dedicated this song to Dottie. We all know somebody in our lives that means everything to us. But for some reason, we haven't had the courage to go to them or to say there's something we need to know. And I'm so thankful that my aunt came over that day and did that and shared it with my mom and shared it with me, because I look back now and I see all the lives that have been transformed from that one woman's faithfulness. I think of the person who, like Billy Graham, that person saw a young man on the street. God saw hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of people who had come to know Christ through him. That faithfulness of that one person that can even talk to you, never know. My aunt shared the gospel with me, and I'm not sharing it with everybody else in this world. Praise God. But this is a song called Hello, Old Friend, and we'll end. And by the way, all of these songs that are my songs, plus some of the hymns, are on my CD, which I sell for $10. The money that we bring in through the offering, 100% of that goes to feed Christians in Pakistan. Which I won't get into all that if we don't have time right now, but 98.3% of the population of Pakistan is Muslim. 1.3% are Christians. And in a caste system, Christians are at the very bottom. And they don't have a social welfare system. They don't have food stamps. They don't have any of that. So these people who are out of work with COVID and all, they're literally starving. And so we've been working on sending them money every month just to one community. I figured, well, I'd rather make a big splash in one small place and affect a couple hundred people's lives than trying to just, you know. So that's what we've been doing. So 100% of your offering either goes to them, or it goes to domestic violence ministries, Christian domestic violence ministries. Because sadly, the numbers on domestic violence have, a couple of years ago, the number was 1 in 4 women were victims of domestic violence. Today, that number sadly is 1 in 3. And we work with organizations that help women get out from the bad situations they're in. They rescue them from those situations that they've started. So, and that's a real important work, because my wife, if she were out here, had been through an abusive relationship. Her daughter was through an abusive relationship. So many people in our world have been. And I just, so we give money, all of it goes to those two things. We don't take a penny of that. Thank you. We make any income for us comes off our books, my book sales, or anyways, here's a little old friend. Found your dreams.
wanted you to know. The place in my heart you hold, the joy you bring, a breath of spring that fills my heart and soul. Somehow words, they just can't express this simple prayer I pray. But more than anything I ask, I hope you find the way. 'Cause only Jesus saves. Only Jesus saves. For so many years we've shared the scrapbooks of our lives, but somehow I could never share the one hope I did find. I didn't know how you would take it then. Would you laugh at me? Would you cry? Now I hope you'll reach your heart the same way he reached mine. 'Cause only Jesus saves. Only Jesus saves.
Savior, that he has forgiven my sins, that he has cleansed me of all iniquity. If you prayed that prayer, if you said those words, then you are now a child of God, born and bought by the blood of the Lord, by the blood of the Lamb. Father, we thank you for this service, Lord. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. God bless everyone. Thank you.